It draws me to your heart. It makes my spirit sing. It makes my spirit sing. Your grace, so oh, I hear it call my name. I'm waking up to sing. I'm waking up to sing. Your cross, it draws me to your heart. It makes my spirit sing. It makes my spirit sing. Your grace, so oh, I hear it call my name. I'm waking up to sing. I'm waking up to sing. We will sing and shout, yeah. Sing and shout. Open up our hearts and pour your praises out. We will sing and shout, yeah. Sing and shout. Open up our hearts and pour your praises out. Sing it out, sing it out. Sing it out, sing it out. Because your love came down. It makes me wanna sing, it makes me wanna sing. Because you call my name. I'm waking up to sing, I'm waking up to sing. We will sing and shout, yeah, sing and shout. Open up our hearts and pour your praises out. We will sing and shout, yeah, sing and shout. Open up our hearts and pour your praises out. What could be better than the grace that washes all our shame away? What could be better than your great love? What could be better than the grace that leads us home and makes a way? What could be better than your great love? What could be better than the grace that washes all our shame away? What could be better than your great love? What could be better than the grace that leads us home and makes a way? What could be better than your great love? We will sing and shout, yeah, sing and shout. Open up our hearts and pour your praises out. We will sing and shout, open up our hearts and pour your praises out. We will sing and shout, yeah, sing and shout. Open up our hearts and pour your praises out. We will sing and shout, yeah, sing and shout. Open up our hearts and pour your praises out.
You don't know Sunday. 'cause I'll never impress you. I just wanna feel okay again. I bet you got pushed around. Somebody made you cold, but the cycle ends right now. 'Cause you can't lead me down that road. And you don't know, you don't know. Someday I'll be living in a big old city.
I see you're surviving the blizzard of 13 so far, huh? Accumulations are deep. There's big drifts out there across the parking lot, and you made your way in here. I am so grateful that you're here. And among all of those of you who are here this morning, I am so glad to have one of our own family back here with us this morning. He is a star football player in the Canadian Football League. He's our very own Hugh Charles. Hugh, would you stand? We want to welcome you home. Good to see Hugh back. And we remember those glory days watching Hugh play football here, then off to University of Colorado, and everybody would go, Hugh, Hugh, let's give Hugh one big Hugh. Hugh, Hugh, there you go. Okay, that's good. Isn't that awesome? What other church in the world could you go to and get to do that, huh? Isn't that great? It's great to see all of you here this morning. How many of you have relatives already in for the holiday? You already have family home in yet? How many of you are going to have family coming in for the holiday? Oh, God bless you. Isn't that great? You're going to love the topic matter that our special guest is going to be dealing with this morning. And it is one of those things we look forward to every year, is being able to have Dr. Jerry Thorpe with us for a weekend. We're a contemporary church, so we don't have a lot of traditions, but he is one of the traditions that we have each and every year. He always blesses us, and he's going to be talking about something that every one of us have to deal with, particularly at the holiday season. He's talking about anger. And so I know you're going to be blessed by his message. You did a tremendous job last night. I'm glad you're here. Dr. Jerry Thorpe, for nearly 40 years, pastored one of the largest churches in Texas out in Odessa, the Temple Church, and now he travels all over the country. He serves on the board of Liberty University. He's a great friend and mentor. I am so honored to have him here. Would you welcome our dear friend, Dr. Jerry Thorpe?
Thank you, man.
Oh, yeah, it is.
Good morning. Delighted to be back at the Met. Did you find the last song a little interesting? All you gotta be, all you're gotta be is mean, and you're always gonna be mean. Well, Rob picked that out because it goes with the message, I guess, that I'm giving you this morning. I'm going to give you a little biblical encouragement on the subject of anger, which I think we all need. In fact, let me take a little survey. How many of you say, you know, Jerry, to be honest, I could use a little encouragement from the Bible on anger? Be honest. How many? Okay. How many of you say, now I can use a little message on anger, but the person I'm married to really needs a lesson on anger? How many of you like, okay, right. How many of you say, I'm raising a teenager, I got a right to be mad? Anybody like that? Oh yeah, quite a few of you too. I don't know, it seems as we look around in our life, there's lots of short fuses. Seems like there's a lot of angry people. I guess we could both make a list. Drivers on the streets are angry, angry people in the workplace, angry kids at school, angry fans at sporting events. There's a lot of people in America. Have you ever seen so many angry people about politics? It's incredible. And even some churches get angry people who sow so much discord. And unfortunately, even family members get angry. Too many homes in America are characterized by temper tantrums and shouting and sometimes even breaking, throwing things. Terrible things who people who love each other to allow themselves to do. Because anger puts a terrible burden on any family. Proverbs 21:9 says, it is better to live in the corner of a roof than in a house with a quarrelsome wife. You remember that old song in the 60s sung by the Drifters called Up on the Roof? That was written by a guy with a mad wife. That's the reason he's up there on that roof all the time trying to get away from her. One husband told a marriage counselor, I'm just temperamental. To which his wife replied, yeah, you're 98% temper and 2% mental. And one wife said, I have a fierce temper, but I suppose that's my cross to bear. To which her pastor replied, that's not your cross, that's your sin. It's your husband's cross to bear. But family anger can get worse. 60%, 6 out of every 10 homicides, are one angry family member killing another. Domestic violence is the single worst cause of injury to women in America. Every 9 seconds, a husband, an ex-husband, or an intimate partner batters a woman. 20% of all emergency room calls by women are the result of domestic violence. Obviously, anger can cause us to say things and do things we will regret for the rest of our lives. There's a little saying, speak when you're angry and you'll make the best speech that you will ever regret. Now, of course, we all get angry as we all raised our hands, or I can use some encouragement on anger. Sometimes we don't think it's that big a deal, but the Bible makes it plain why anger is so dangerous and gives us instructions of why we should control our anger. It's from Ephesians chapter 4, and we're going to begin verse 26 and go through the end of the chapter. And then I'm going to give you 6 thoughts about anger from the Word of God that are just expositorily given in these verses. So would you like to read it along? It'll be on the screen. The first thought is this: God said, be angry and do not sin. And the second point is, don't let the sun go down on your wrath. And the third point is, don't give a place to the devil. Don't get a foothold to the devil. Be angry and sin not. Don't let the sun go down on your wrath. Don't give a place to the devil. Then the fourth thought, let no corrupt communication. Be careful of what you speak and how you speak. Don't let corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but speak that which is good for the use of building up others, that you may minister grace to them. And the fifth point, don't grieve the Holy Spirit of God that lives within you, by which you have been sealed to the day of redemption. And then the last two verses, kind of God says, get rid of this in your life and replace it with this. In verse 31, he said, let bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, evil speaking shouldn't be a part of your life. Put it away from you with all malice and replace it with being kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, being patient with each other. And then to cinch it down, God said, the basis I ask you to do this is because God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven you. And who has done anything worse to us than what many of us did to Jesus Christ before we found him in our lives? So here's six thoughts. First of all, anger is a warning light. Be angry and do not sin. It's a warning light in your life. Now, anger in and of itself is not sin. The Bible speaks of God's anger 18 times in the Old Testament. The Bible speaks that God got angry against sin and rebellion. And if I ask you, could you tell me a time Jesus Christ got angry? You all could, when he got angry and took a little whip and cleansed the temple of the money changers. Anger in all of our lives is a natural impulse, which can be used for good or it can be used for evil. It's like a fire. A fire can warm your house, and that is good. But a fire can also burn down your house. And the distinction is fire must be controlled. When anger takes the form of righteous indignation, it can give us courage to stand up against things that need to be stood up against. But when anger takes the form of selfishness or vengeance, it can destroy lifelong relationships. And I think the Apostle Paul in these verses is warning us to see what is behind our anger before it leads to worse things. What makes you mad? What makes you angry? I've been here enough. Some of you, you've heard me talk a little bit about my wife. Her name is Freddie. She's a girl, as I've told you before. She's a girl. Her name is Freddie. We've been married 55 years last June and love that girl a whole lot. And I am 6'4" and she's not. And so I drive a big car and she drives a little Nissan ZX. And a couple of ZXs ago, she had this little car, and she'd say, would you like to drive my car today? And I thought she's being nice, not realizing she's just out of gas. And so I get in the car and back out and start down the road. And I don't go very far till there's a little lady in an Asian voice saying, fuel level is low, fuel level is low. You know what that is? That's a warning voice. It tells me of a problem that I need to deal with. Some people take those voices out or take those lights out, but the problem's not the voice or the lights. The problem is I have an empty gas tank. That's what I'm talking to you about anger. When you get angry, the first thing you need to do is back up and say, what is making me so angry? Because anger is a warning light. What lies behind it? Well, sometimes we're angry because we're frustrated about the circumstances of life. I pastored long enough to realize that sometimes you're living your life and it's going pretty normal, and then you get hit with a disease or an illness, a sickness of some kind, and your life changes and you can't do what you used to do. And sometimes you're even facing a terminal situation. And a lot of times people react with anger because they're frustrated. Sometimes in our marriages, we run into difficulties and somebody strays a little and we get angry. I had a man after the service last night come to me and said, I need to repair, but I get so angry dealing with the situation. Sometimes we can have a conflict at our job and that's what lies behind the anger. Or sometimes it is disappointment in ourselves. I retired 13 years ago of the church in Odessa where I pastored all those years, and I travel and speak each weekend now. And I come home, and sometimes I've been home a little while, and Freddie says, why are you so grumpy? Well, sometimes you're tired, and sometimes I'm disappointed because the message didn't go the way I wanted. I didn't, connect, and I come home and I'm disappointed in myself and I get angry at myself. Sometimes it's fear. fear of what's going to happen with our finances or in our nation, and we get fearful and we get angry because of this fear. There's a beautiful example of that in Mark chapter 4, where Jesus and his disciples were on a boat, and Jesus was asleep. And there came a great storm, and the boat was tossed, and the disciples were frightened that they were going to die. So they woke up Jesus, and with angry voices they demanded, "Master, don't you care that we are perishing?" And Jesus arose. And how did he deal with their anger? It's fascinating. He did not say to his disciples, "Why are you so angry?" He did say, "Why are you so afraid?" It's like Jesus said, "You didn't look beyond this thing. Don't you know this boat can't sink with me in it? So why are you so afraid?" He asked them to look behind and see what's causing their anger. Did you ever come home and for you that have children, and your children are just being little boys, little girls, but you're on a short fuse and you jump on those kids and it's not really because of anything they did. You're mad at the traffic. Are you mad at your boss? Are you mad because your team lost a big game? Or because the stock market went down? Or because the weather's going to mess up? Sometimes anger is just selfishness. When we don't have everything go our way, our response is to get mad. Have you been married long enough to know that it's really hard to tell a story without your wife's assistance? Did you ever start a story and you love to tell this story and you say, "And we left on a Tuesday," and your wife said, "It wasn't Tuesday, it was Wednesday." And you said, "We stopped at McDonald's," and she says, "It wasn't McDonald's, it was Burger King." That make you mad? You know why God made Adam first and then later he made Eve? So Adam could tell one story in his life without being interrupted by his wife. That's why. It's just selfishness. Or sometimes anger is just a habit. It's what you have allowed yourself to do when you handle problems. You just get angry. Well, anger is a warning light. And God is saying, when you get angry, why don't you back up and ask the real question as to what is behind your anger? Because that's what you need to deal with God's help. Anger is a warning light. Second thought, anger can become your disposition. If you don't deal with your anger and what's causing your anger, it can become your disposition. Don't let the sun go down on your wrath. Don't tolerate it. Don't become known as an angry person. Did you guys ever have a bad argument with your wife and you took your argument to bed at night and you laid down in bed and the argument escalated in bed and you, genius that you were, got so mad you jumped out of bed, threw the covers back, stomped out of the room, slammed the door so hard that you knocked that little plaque off the wall that said, "God bless our happy home," right there on the floor. And you stomped out of the room and you slept on the couch. Let me ask you a question. Did you get a good night's sleep? Did you wake up refreshed the next morning? No, anger became your disposition. Jonah was like that. He's an Old Testament prophet. And God asked him to go preach to the Assyrian capital of Nineveh because their wickedness had come before him. And Jonah didn't want to go, because he hated the Assyrian people, because they were the scourge military of that world, and they might have killed some of Jonah's family even. We don't know. But when God said, "I want you to go preach to them," Jonah realized if God wanted to destroy Nineveh, he doesn't need a prophet. The idea of him sending someone to preach to them means he could forgive them. And he said no, and took off in the other direction. And you know the great story we learned in Sunday school of Jonah and the great fish, and up and down for 3 days, and then the fish hurled him, and Jonah was then glad to do what God wanted him to do. And the Bible said he entered the city, and he had a very negative message, which was 40 days and you will be overthrown. And it was like, yes, you know, he was glad that they were going to be overthrown. But they believed him. And they believed God. And from the king all the way down to the servant, they repented. They sat in sackcloth, which is a sign of mourning and repentance. And God saw their repentance, and God forgave them. And everybody's happy. God's happy. The people are happy. But Jonah was not happy. And when you read his little four-chapter book, anger becomes his disposition. And he sits on a hillside and he looks over and thinking maybe God will change his mind and go ahead and nuke these people. Anger became his disposition. Well, the Bible is plain, guys, that you're not to be known as an angry person. You don't tolerate anger. You don't let it linger unresolved in your life. You don't let it become your disposition. There was a woman who was concerned about her husband's salvation, so she talked to her pastor and said, I just wish you would talk to my husband. And when he talked to the man said, you know, Pastor, I'm not particularly an unreligious man, but if Christianity would make me as angry as my wife, I don't really want any part of it. I have a little saying. Nothing you do can hurt God's character. God's character will always be the same. But an angry Christian really hurts God's reputation. Anger is a warning light. Don't let anger become your disposition. Don't tolerate anger. Third, anger opens the door to a greater evil. Neither give place to the devil. Don't give the devil a foothold. I want to use another biblical example. Cain and Abel, the first boys born to Adam and Eve, brothers, of course. And in the passage of time, they came to worship God. And obviously God had told them how he wanted to be approached. So Abel brought a blood sacrifice, which was a picture of hundreds of years later, thousands of years in fact, when the Son of God would come and die as a sacrifice on Calvary's cross. Abel believed that God would send his son and pictured that by blood sacrifice. Cain, on the other hand, brought the works of his own hands. He brought what he had done. Instead of accepting what God had done for him, he wanted to show what he had done. So he brought probably a magnificent offering. And the Bible said God respected Abel and did not respect Cain's offering. Now pick it up. It's going to be on your screen. But he did not respect Cain and his offering. Now follow it along with where we've been. And Cain was very angry, and his countenance fell. Anger is a warning light. Cain, why are you so angry? His countenance fell, which means anger became his disposition. And then notice, God tried to reason with him. And the Lord said, Cain, why are you so angry? Why haven't you thought about what's making you so angry? And why have you let it become your disposition? And God said, look, if you do well, you will be accepted. And if you do not do well, sin lies at your door. And sin's desire is to possess you. But you should rule over sin. So what did Cain do? In his smoldering anger, he killed his brother. Now, was the issue between Cain and Abel? No, the issue was between Cain and God. But when anger became his disposition, the fallout of his anger fell upon his brother. That's the way it generally happens. We get angry, and if we don't deal with it, and if we become an angry person, the fallout of our anger hurts innocent people. Proverbs 14:17 says, an angry person does foolish things. Will Rogers said years ago, when you fly off the handle, you seldom make a safe landing. There's a great story from the Amos and Andy. It was a great show. Probably none of you younger guys ever saw it, but Amos is walking down the street one day, and he's got an overcoat on, and there's a bulge in the front of his overcoat. And he met Andy, his friend, and Andy said, where are you going? And he said, I'm going to meet a friend. And he said, well, why is this bulge in your overcoat? He said, because every time I meet that friend and talk to him, and when he talks to me, he pokes me in the chest. And that makes me mad. So I have two sticks of dynamite taped to my chest. And this time when he pokes me on the chest, I'm going to blow his fingers off. I want to ask you a question. Will he blow his fingers off? Is that all of the damage that's going to be done? Have you ever lit out with two sticks of dynamite on your chest and I'm going to give them a piece of my mind? I'm going to settle this. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. And you go and set off that dynamite, and maybe you do get a little satisfaction. But the fallout of that is horrible. Because you see, when anger, the warning light is ignored and it becomes your disposition, then the devil kind of gets in the situation and pushes you farther and makes you angrier. And all of a sudden you're doing things you regret for the rest of your life. Proverbs 29:22 says, a hot-tempered man commits many sins. There's another little saying I like, anger is a wind that blows out the lamp of the mind. We don't think straight when anger becomes our disposition. And here's a great little piece of advice for your marriage and your life from the book of James chapter 1. Here's a great marriage verse. Be swift to hear. A lot of anger would be solved in our marriage if one or both could just kind of tamp it down and sit down like two loving adults and listen. Don't try to out-talk each other. Don't try to out-volume each other. Just be swift to hear. Let the other person talk. Let them express themselves. They may find the solution while just talking to you. And listen. Be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to answer back, slow to get mad, slow to raise the volume. Be swift to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. Great advice. Anger is a warning light. What makes you so mad? Anger can become your disposition. And when anger becomes your disposition, you give a foothold. Fourth thought, anger expressed in words. Paul said, look, let no corrupt word come out of your mouth. All of us, when you get mad, even at people you love, I have got mad stupidly to this girl who's walked by my side and been the greatest girl in the world. And I have said things I wish I could just reach out there and stuff right back in my mouth. Paul is saying when you get mad, you say things that doesn't build other people up, that doesn't benefit those that listen. So don't let corrupt words proceed out of your mouth. Control your tongue when you're aggravated. Because angry words can be used like a weapon in the life of a person. Proverbs 12:18 said, there is one who speaks like the piercing of a sword. When I was pastoring in Odessa, there was a guy who was one of the more successful businessmen in the community. We were having lunch one day and he said, you know, Jerry, I was giving my wife golf lessons and I was videoing it. And I went back and looked at that video later and I was so embarrassed with myself at how I was talking to her. I did not realize how my words sounded. I did not realize how I put her down. I did not realize how I cut her down. When I was pretending to help her, I was so critical, so short-tempered. He said it embarrassed me. You see, a real test of our Christianity is not how we talk in here on the weekend. A real test of our Christianity is how we talk Friday night when the meal went wrong, or how we talked when we're driving to work or home, or how we talk at home, how we talk when we're squeezed. The one thing God said for me and Freddie, Jerry, I want you to love her like I love the church and I died for the church. That's the way I want you to love her. And I want you to love your children, and I want your children to love you. And I want Christians to love each other. Jesus said in Mark, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples, because you love each other. And when you love someone, when you really love someone, anger should not be easy. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 5 said, love is not easily angered. When you love someone, it seems like we ought to control that sharp tongue and that loud voice and that anger to people we love. Love your husband, love your wife, love your children. Love the people who walk with you in the faith of God. Because when we speak angry words, sometimes we don't understand. There's another verse, Proverbs said, chapter 15, verse 1, a soft answer turns away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger. Anger spoken is really bad. And my fifth thought is, if we allow anger to be a part of our life, it distances us from God. The verse said, don't grieve the Holy Spirit of God by whom you were sealed until the day you're redeemed forever. I was saved when I was an 18-year-old freshman in college, and I was messed up when I got saved between God and Jerry Thorpe and a lot of other ways. And when I got saved, the next day, I got saved on a Sunday, and the next day I went back to the job and I was kind of in the same language I'd been before. You understand what I'm saying? And I started using those words. And for the first time in my life, something inside of me said, whoa, time out. You're a Christian now. You're a believer. Something new's on the inside. And I understood for the first time that when I accepted Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit moved into my life. The Bible said our body is a tabernacle of the Holy Spirit who dwells in us. And the Holy Spirit is like a resident coach. The player's here tonight. He has a coach. The Holy Spirit is a resident coach to help me live and act and talk and be more like Jesus Christ. But you know something? When I get angry, I forget everything he's taught me. And the Holy Spirit is one friend I cannot afford to alienate. But anger distances us from God. And then my last thought, anger can be replaced by Christ-like qualities. And these last two verses simply say, as I emphasized when we started, let these things be put away from you. You make up your mind, bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking, be put away with all malice and replaced. You can be angry or you can be calm. You can speak harsh words or you can speak kind words. You can tear people down or you can build people up. It's your choice. That's what God said. It's your choice. I want you to put this stuff away and I want you to replace it. Now, some of us have probably been taught since childhood the way to deal with anger is just suppress it, hold it inside. But guys, that's like trying to hold a beach ball under the water. It keeps popping back up. And others say, just let it out. Let it out. Scream if you need to. Let it all out. But wow, that doesn't really never work for me, because the louder I get, the angrier I get. And it doesn't work. There's a great little deal in the movie Forrest Gump. It's toward the end of the movie when Forrest and Jenny have got married, they have the baby, and they come back to that old dilapidated house where Jenny grew up. And if you're mine, you go back to the first of the Forrest Gump movie, and you remember Forrest, he was a little boy, and he came over to Jenny for them to go play. And you remember Jenny came running out of the house and running through the corn, and her daddy was saying, come back, Jenny, come back. And you got an idea, something's going on in that house. And at the end of the movie, Forrest and Jenny come back to that dilapidated old house. You remember the scene? All of a sudden, all of that sexual abuse that she took in that house from her father boiled over. And Jenny began to pick up rocks and throw them at the house and picked up rocks. And the photography's pretty intense. She throws the rocks and throws the rocks and throws the rocks until she just fell exhausted. And Forrest Gump looked at her and said philosophically, sometimes there just aren't enough rocks. There's just not enough rocks. I think that's what God says to us. You just throwing rocks in your marriage? Come on, there's not enough rocks. You're throwing rocks at society and when you're driving and whatever you do. No, God said, no. Why don't you drop the rocks? Just drop the rocks. Jim Nicodem, who's a pastor in Illinois and preached a message on anger that kicked me off and gave me so much help for this. In his message that I listened to on a cassette, he quoted a guy named Dr. Les Carter, who wrote a book called Good and Angry. And in this book, he said, anyone who lives a life of anger is choosing to do so. It's a choice. You said, well, no. My mama was an angry person, and so I'm an angry. No. You're wrong. Your mother was an angry person because she chose to be an angry person. And if you're an angry person, you're choosing to be an angry person. And if every time you get squeezed, you react with anger, you're choosing to do that. And God is saying, and Paul is saying, and the preacher's trying to say it to you this morning, don't choose it. Get rid of anger and replace it in your life. Just stop, stuff it in. What's making me so mad? Deal with that. And don't go any further. Don't let it become your disposition. Don't give the devil a foothold. Don't let corrupt words come out of your mouth. Don't grieve the Spirit of God. Replace it. Let me bring this plane to a landing. There's an interesting verse in your Bible that says, God is angry with the wicked every day. So if you're haven't accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior and He's not a reality to you, does that mean God's got clenched fist towards you? Let me describe it with the little story of the prodigal son in Luke 15. The father's a type of God, the boy's a type of me and maybe a type of you. Great dad, loved his boy, gave him everything, and the boy didn't love his dad, didn't appreciate his dad, took everything his dad would give him and wasted in riotous living and got as far away from his dad as he could. Some of you understand. I understand. I took all that God could give me and got as far away from God as I could as a young man. Now, the Bible says God so loved the world that He gave His Son to die. How could you love more than that? I know God loved me, but I know He was angry at the way I was living. And this boy, this prodigal, got away from his father and wasted his life and ended up in a hog pen. And he was broke and he was busted and he was at the bottom. He was so hungry. And one day he stood up in the hog pen and said, I'm going to go home. I'm going to go back to my dad. I'm not worthy to be your son. I'm going to tell my dad, Dad, I'm not worthy to be your son. I've wasted my life. I'm not worthy to be your son. Just make me a servant around the house. And he started toward home. He was broke. He was busted. He was covered in hog mud. He had been in a hog pen. You could probably smell him before you could see him. But he's going home to his dad. Now, I know his dad every day was angry at the way that boy lived. But I pictured it one time when I was preaching to teenagers. Every day, mama said, honey, is our boy coming home? And maybe dad put a ladder up at the side of the house and climbed the ladder and looked down the road and said, I don't see him. But one day he got at the top of the ladder and said, honey, I see our boy. Our boy's coming home. And he ran down that ladder. And the Bible said he ran down the road and he gathered that boy and all of his dirt and all of his filth. And the boy said, Dad, I'm not worthy to be your son. And his dad put his hand over his mouth and said, bring the best robe and bring a ring. My son was lost and is found. And he welcomed him home. That's what happened to me. When one day in a service like this, I walked to the presence of the God that I'd gotten so far away and said, God, I'm not worthy of anything. And God welcomed me back into his embrace. And that's the day my life changed. I just wonder if you're not at the point in your life that you'd like to come home to God. Come home to God. So we're just going to, in a moment, we're going to stand, and Rob and the group are going to come out and sing softly. And the invitation's in two parts. There will be people at the front to help if you need somebody to pray with. But wouldn't it be good if all of you that struggle with anger would get off the pride of this deal and not be embarrassed to walk up at the church and just stand here at the front in a minute and say, God, your word is right. I need to control this in my life, and I'm going to control it. And maybe you're here this morning and you need Jesus Christ, and you'd come like the prodigal and come to one of the people here at the front and simply say, I want to come back to God. Let's stand together with heads bowed all over the building. Heads bowed. Father, thank you for your goodness to us. Thank you for the instruction of your word, which is so plain. And oh God, I just pray right now that people might come back to you. Those who need to come and say, God, I'm sorry for my anger. And others who need to come and find God, may they step out and do that this morning as Rob and the group sing. And in this moment, it's a time for you to pray. If you'd like to come and just stand here at the front and pray, and then you may go back and sit down. If you need help, somebody will be here to help you. God help you. God help you to do that as they sing.